You know, I remember when I was living at Elmshaven, many do not know this, but my favorite dessert was lemon meringue pie. Oh, when I would see that the cook had prepared a lemon meringue pie, it was a good day. Well, there was a certain gentleman, that kept arriving at our door right around dinner time. Oh, he'd sort of worn out his welcome, but we still invited him in. One night I went out and I saw on the sideboard a lemon meringue pie. Oh, it was a good day. We sat down and had our dinner and were served the lemon meringue pie. Oh, I took my fork, took a big bite of lemon meringue pie, only to realize that the cook had accidentally put salt instead of sugar. Pretty soon I heard a knock at the door, and our friend arrived just in time for dinner. So we invited him in and watched him as he ate. At the end of the meal, I turned to the cook and I said, "Cut him a generous slice of pie." And we watched our friend choke down the pie. You know, I know that many people think I am so stern because most of the time my pictures look exactly like this. And you realize that is, of course, because the film is so slow, often we must stand for several minutes. And so if you don't want a blurry mouth, you stand exactly like this. And I love to make sure that especially the children know that a merry heart doeth good unto the soul. And so I love to share stories with the children. When I'm at Elmshaven, the secretary, my secretary, often tries to keep my grandchildren from bothering me. As I'm working on the last books of the testimonies, and my children will come home from school, and there's a back stairwell just outside the kitchen, and they'll come up those stairs, and I'll have often a little piece of fruit or maybe a cookie to share with them, and they'll sit at my feet. Oh, I love to tell them stories, to share the stories with them. I remember there's a story, and I want to remind you that I was not laughing at our friend, but I did have a little chuckle. We were taking the packet boats. Have you used the packet boat, those little water taxis that go from one? Maybe you haven't had an opportunity to use those. Well, we often would go a little water taxi just from one little place to another. And James and myself and our friend Joseph Bates were going to take the packet boat. And I'm not sure if you've even heard of Joseph Bates' reputation for hanging on to a dollar bill. Oh, he often wouldn't give me money when I needed it. He would tightly grasp that dollar bill. He had the money for our fare, and we stood at the little dock waiting for the packet boat. He had his hat in one hand and the dollar bill in the other. Well, soon the packet boat, we could see it. And it didn't seem like it was going to stop, but it was going slowly. And while James, he decided, we should run and take a leap onto the boat. And so he took my hand, and he's a big, strong man, and we ran and we jumped and we landed on the packet boat. Joseph Bates was a little behind us, and he always was not fit. And he backed up and he took a run and he made a leap and he landed in the water. But he hung on to that dollar bill and his hat in the other hand. Well, I had a little chuckle at that. Oh, that's one of the stories I love to tell my grandchildren, just to remind them that we can enjoy life. We can love the Lord with all our hearts and even our senses of humor. You know, in the early days, part of our message was the health message. And it was developing as we were growing. As our little company would grow and the Lord gave us more light, we knew that this was good news that we needed to share. It was an integral part of our health message was the elements included fresh water, sunlight, exercise, good diet. We had these elements, but we knew there must be the divine power. Trust in God. I remember we were able to take a rest up at Dr. Jackson's water treatments, his sanitarium, and enjoy the water treatments there. Oh, we had nearly worn ourselves to death. In fact, you know what they were calling us? I got news of this from some folk. They weren't calling us the Seventh-day Adventists. They were calling us the Seventh-day Invalid Party. We were so sick from doing God's work. We had worn ourselves nearly to death. And my husband, James, was the worst. Oh, he was close to death, preparing a tract called How Shall We Live? Wasn't a very good example of our message. So we went up to Dr. Jackson's. We spent some time there, and there were things there that were so wonderful that blessed us. There was truly revolutionary, but there were things there that I could not abide, that I did not believe was in keeping with God's plan for us. There was dancing and card playing, and worst of all, idleness. Now, I asked some children, you know what idleness is? And they said, when you have idols in your house. And I said, not quite that, and I will explain to them. Well, we knew that we must, if we were to keep what we were doing in God's line, that we must establish our own sanitariums and hospitals, places where people could learn the principles of health, but also be reminded of God's divine power. And so we were able to establish the Health Institute, our very first one in Battle Creek. We hadn't done it up to this time because we did not want folks to think that we were building, that we were collecting here on earth. It would be a denial of our firm belief in the hope of Jesus soon coming. But soon we saw that it was absolutely necessary, and it was by God's grace that we opened our first sanitarium. I remember helping our dear friend, John Harvey Kellogg. I remember my husband and I, we prayed about it, and we decided we should sponsor him through medical school. Sadly, John Harvey stopped listening to God's voice. His brother Merritt stayed with us, and he was of great use to the Lord. There were many times in my life that God raised me up because my health had always been frail. I know some of you heard the little story of myself being hit by the little girl. You know that one of the first lessons I learned was forgiveness for her. She felt so badly. She came to help me with my lessons after she had thrown that rock at me, and I knew that I must forgive her immediately. Well, my health has always been frail. There are many times when I've come to a camp meeting and they've brought me up onto the stage, onto the platform, and laid me on a cot. And only God's strength in me was able to rise up and tell the words, share the words that God has given me. There is a hope that we have. And I cling to that hope. We should never live as those who have no hope. We are called to the higher calling because we know. You know, as I've traveled, I've met many who, with tears in their eyes, who are facing the sunsets of their lives, who have come to me and said, I thought I was going to see Jesus in my lifetime. I thought I would see Jesus come again in my lifetime. We still live just beyond the river. It's just a little while. And no matter what stage of your life you're in, cling to the hope. Cling to the hope that God has promised, and He will bring it to pass. He does not make idle promises. When He says it, He means it. He will bring you through. You know, as I shared again with you this morning, those that were here, I have always had a burden for our young people. I carry it with an ache in my heart. They are so vital. For those who are teachers, who are Sabbath school leaders, who have an influence in our children's lives, now is the time that we must uplift them and encourage them, but in the right manner. We must give them the strength it will take to take us through to that grand day. They are so needed in our family. And to our young people, I say, with such an army of workers as our youth might provide, how soon the end might come, the end of suffering and sin, where in place of a possession here, they might inherit the promised land. Our youth. But they must learn from you, and they will not learn from you if you're not involved in their lives, if you're not sharing the stories that have come from the pioneers. I remember in the early days, so many folks sacrificed, not just a little, but sacrificed everything for the cause of Christ, to let go of the things that are holding you to earth, the things that mean nothing in the land that we're going to inherit. My friend sacrificed her wedding silver. She sold it so that we might print a tract to share with others. Not sacrificing in small ways, but sacrificing in great ways. And the Lord can take that. And as He did, with miracles, He can grow that into great and mighty things and use what has been given you. It wasn't yours to begin with. But to sacrifice, to be willing to step forward in faith and say, Lord, it is yours. We must invest in our youth. Young people, you must remain steadfast. You must remain firm in your faith and be bold. I challenge you that lead and are involved in our youth to invest in them. You know, as I said this morning, that again, I was only that girl of 17. He had called several before me. One gentleman stepped aside because he was black and because of the Civil War, didn't feel like folks would listen to him. And from these disenfranchised groups, the hand came down on my shoulder. And again, if you're willing, and if you're willing, He will use you. Is there a prophet among you? And because I was willing to take on the mantle and be committed to the cause of Christ, He was able to use me and still continues. the youth are so vital. Don't forget them. They need to be with you. I remember learning to listen to and hear God's voice. Once we were on a train, and someone had blessed us with these tickets for a train ride. Often, you know, we were on what we call corduroy roads in horse and buggy. And oh my, we call them thank you, ma'am, because every time you'd hit one, thank you, ma'am, thank you, ma'am. Well, someone had given us tickets to ride in a train. James and I settled into the car. We looked around and, oh, there was a place to sleep. You can't imagine the luxury for us. And then the Lord impressed me that this is not the car that we should be in. And because of that commitment to listen to God's voice, we went back a car. And James said, we should ride here. And I said, no, we need to move back further and further. Finally, we found a car, and it's like, okay, we can ride here. Well, I remember the whistle and the starting of the engine. Hadn't gone several minutes before I heard the largest and loudest crash I have ever heard. James leaned his head out the window, tried to see what it was. Then he picked me up in his strong arms and carried me to a farmhouse not far away. And he went back to check. And when he saw what had happened, the front cars of the train, including the car we would have been riding in, were now in splinters. There had been a cow on the tracks, and there was an accident, and the whole front of the train was in splinters. We were saved because we learned to listen to God's voice. And once again, his hand of protection was on our lives. I wanted to share some things today with you, that some words that the Lord has given me. First, share a Bible verse. You know, we have this hope. It is an anchor for our soul. Do you believe in that hope? It is an anchor for your soul. Cling to it. When you're feeling despondent, when perhaps a brother or sister has said words of discouragement to you, remember, we have this hope. We have this hope. Jesus, our elder brother, he has prepared the way. He has prepared and promised us that hope. It is the hope that is set before us. We cannot find salvation in our individual selves. No matter how hard we try, our hope is always in Jesus. Do not be discouraged as you face the days ahead. How hard poor mortals have strived to find salvation in themselves, when again, salvation is only to be found in Jesus. He is the sin bearer. He alone can be our substitute. The forerunner of Christ exclaimed, "Behold the Lamb which taketh away the sins of the world." Take your eyes off yourself and encourage hope and confidence in others. Encourage them, point them to Christ. Let your hope not be centered in yourself, but in Him who has entered within the veil. Talk of the blessed hope. The blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our Lord and Jesus Christ. We need to have far less confidence in what man can do and far more confidence in what God can do for every one of believing souls. He longs to reach after, for you to reach after Him by faith. He longs to have you expect great things from Him. He's promised it to you. He can sharpen the intellect. He can give tact and skill. Put your talents to work. Ask God for wisdom, and it will be given to you. again looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God, our Savior. Jesus said, He is building mansions for us where we might be with Him. I hunger and thirst for salvation, and I pray you do. Earthly treasures must not be an inducement to stay with the things of earth. For while we have this hope, it reaches clear above the treasures of earth that are passing away and takes hold of the immortal inheritance, the treasures that are durable, incorruptible, undefiled, and that fade not away. Our mortal bodies may turn to dust and be laid in the grave, even as many of us have watched those we love be laid in the grave. But on that day, Jesus will call forth the believers, those that have been sleeping, those that are dust. We shall then enjoy the fullness of the blessed hope. We know in whom we have believed. We know whom we have believed. We have not labored in vain. In our faithfulness, it is not in vain. A rich and glorious reward is before us, the prize for which we long. There is salvation in us. And why do we stay away? From the fountain of Christ, from the blood-stained banner that He holds. Why not come and drink that your souls, your thirsty souls might be quenched, invigorated, and flourish in God? Why do we cling so closely to earthly things? There's something so far better than we can even imagine. We can be in a heavenly frame of mind now. Oh, let us dwell upon Jesus' lovely, spotless character, to place our minds on heavenly things. We are not to sorrow as those who have no hope. As you toil for the Master, be ever faithful, as He has proved to be to us. And if we should not meet again here on this earth, I'll meet you on the other side, just beyond the river, on that beautiful shore. You know, when we were at Elms Haven, one of my favorite times was when the family was gathered together. My grandchildren, my son and his wife, those who have also taken on the cause for Christ by assisting me. And one of my favorite things was to sing. Oh, I was often heard, I know, some folks probably tired of it, but just to sing around the house. And every child that was gathered around my living room on Friday evenings, and again at the close of the Sabbath day, got to pick a song. And we would sing it together as a family. Oh, I look forward to the day when we can all be together again and to sing on that beautiful shore. I'm wondering if, is the woman who played the piano still here? And there she is. Would you sing with me? And I don't even know the number in these books. These are different than the books that I have a book called The Millennial Harp that William Miller has put together. It's so handy. And I see that this book is far more full of wonderful songs. But would you sing just Shall We Gather at the River with me? And do you know what page that's on? It has come to me that it perhaps is on page 432. And make a promise to me that we will meet again on that beautiful shore. Shall we gather at the river where bright angels' feet have trod, with its crystal tide forever flowing by the throne of God? Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river, gathered with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Sing the last verse with me. Soon we'll reach the shining river. Soon our pilgrimage will cease. Soon our happy hearts will quiver with a melody of peace. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful. For the Lord himself shall descend with the shout of the archangel, and we will be gathered together because we have this hope. We still have this hope. Will you pray with me? Our blessed Lord and Savior. Oh, thank you for stepping in and taking our sins, for providing us with that hope. And Lord, as we go forward, we know your hand of blessing is on us. And I pray that it will go forward, that the words that you've given us will encourage others, and that we will be found faithful in that day to the true calling. Oh Lord, we do love you. And we praise your name today on this Sabbath day. Amen.